15th edition of the Sanoma Knowledge Exchange. Slightly less people in the room yet, but we'll see what will happen. Maybe a few will join after dinner. Yeah, we skipped the high level management guys to do the keynote, because we want to really keep it tech and skip the blah. So that's why I'm doing the introduction, but I'll really keep it short and hand it over to our first presenter of today, who really confirmed, or at least we asked him back after first putting on the agenda for October, because he couldn't make it for the evening schedule. But still on Friday we said, could you please come, because we have this cancelled slot. And we need someone to fill in, and luckily he was still able to make it, and was still correcting like the spelling mistakes from the title slide when he came in. So looking forward to the talk from Red Hat, Janne Korhonen.
Okay, thank you. So I'm working for Red Hat as a pre-sales solution architect here in Finland. And more from the application development point of view. So many know Red Hat from Linux, but we are much else nowadays as well. I used to be responsible for middleware parts under JBoss brand, and also for OpenShift. That's our platform as a service offering. And it's going to be renewed with these latest things in next version, and I'm going to tell about this in this presentation. So Docker and Kubernetes. How many of you have heard about Docker? Almost half, a bit more than half. How many has heard about Kubernetes? 3, 4, okay. So maybe this then will tell something. And how many have read about microservices? Some as well, good. And how many has heard about OpenShift? Not too many, too bad. So let's start from a bit of overview what is happening in the field of IT, and more from the development processes and how it reflects in the architecture. So last, like, let's see, 15 years, companies have been moving from waterfall-based development processes to more agile development. The software has been done in smaller pieces, so that there's a feedback loop is shorter, that it's easier to see that if there's a fit for market in the IT project. But it still has been kind of fixed term projects that end somewhere and release something at the end. And nowadays we are moving more to DevOps kind of model, where there's more like a constant stream of value in the development. There's not, the software is not ready. It's never ready, it's always developing, and there might be like tens or hundreds of new releases each day. And it requires automation and different kind of organizations for the how to develop that stuff. But basically, a good metaphor could be that in the photo wall model, we developed like writing a book. It took long time, and then we noticed that if it's there's market for book or not. And then we move to more like kind of blogging metaphor, that we write shorter blogs, and the feedback is more constant. And with DevOps, we are moving to like kind of Twitter, that there's constant feed of new stuff, and it's a threshold to try something new is very, very low, that it's easy to test something, and if it works, then put more effort on that. If not, then forget it. So it's also related to kind of like growth hacking type of approach to services, like Facebook, Amazon, these companies, they release hundreds of new changes every day, and they release multiple variations of these new functionality to different groups and test which one is working, and then promote that one for whole user base. And there's a new kind of approach how to develop software, and that reflects in the architecture that we from, let's say, 90s we have had these multi-tier entire architectures with web layer, business logic and data layers, and this pretty standard architecture for applications. And now we are moving to microservices based architecture, and it's related to DevOps. If you do a lot of updates to application, it's less risk if you have split that application to small pieces and don't update whole application at once. And this with microservices, it's easier to do this updating, but it requires this automation. If it's manual process to deploy application, then it's not going to be possible to have multiple services per application. So basically microservices means that you have small applications instead of big monolithic. Usually it's REST interface, backend, and then HTML5 frontend integrates in those small microservices on the backend. And microservices brings other benefits as well. It eases like changing technology. You don't have to change technology for a whole application. You can change it one microservice per microservice, and you can utilize different technologies for different services as fit for purpose. Scaling is easier. You can scale only the bottleneck service, not whole application, etc. So there are a lot of good things to use microservices, but there are some bad things as well. So microservices need to be stateless. So it's easy to scale and create new ones and kill unnecessary ones, and that means that stateless, you need different kind of services from the backend that you run those services, and like log management. If the services are stateless, you can kill the services, and logs would disappear if you don't centralize those somewhere. So log management and monitoring is one thing that is different from traditional applications. So transaction management, state management, you usually have some cache, in-memory cache or database to store state. You cannot store those in the microservice. And load balancing, these kind of things, how to scale and manage this. Microservices need new kind of platform to run, and many are developing them manually from different puzzle pieces together. But there's emerging new field of platform as a service, kind of next generation application server that can run these microservices and provide the services to run those. And OpenShift is one of those platforms. And how it reflects to infrastructure. We are used to have virtual machines on private data center or from web online clouds, but there's now new emerging technology called containers. So Docker is container. So container is like a virtual machine, but it uses the operating system is common for all these virtual machines. So it's kind of operating system level virtualization. So each container thinks that he has whole operating systems for himself, but in reality there are multiple containers in the same operating system. And Docker is famous for being the format for kind of image format. When we have virtual machine image formats, Docker is kind of format for having these container images. And when we use microservices, having a lot of, like it's typical use case that you have one application per one virtual machine, you would have too much virtual machines and overhead of having operating system on each of those if you run those on virtual machines. So microservices are very good to run in containers or with Docker, as you can have a lot of them in a small space, and the operating system doesn't multiply to each container. And it's very small in size and fast to start up and easy to experiment with. So containers are kind of de facto environment to run microservices. And it's very good for Red Hat, as we are containers are based on Linux kernels, and we are the Linux operating system company. So compared to some companies like Docker, they don't have operating system, and it could be hard to maintain them in real production environments. So that's why Red Hat is heavily investing in this area with multiple product lines. OpenShift. By the way, what is the time? I need to quit. 1:30. Okay. OpenShift. We started developing OpenShift 5 years ago already. We acquired a company called Makara, and then we placed that software we acquired to Amazon and provided it as a service to developers, a technical preview command test. And it was 3 years ago we then, based on that experience, released a product called OpenShift. And there's an online version, openshift.com. You can freely try it. And then we have private OpenShift Enterprise for private, like private clouds, data centers. This is from last year figures. Last year there was 2 million applications in OpenShift Online running, and the density OpenShift V2 was running on containers on our own format, not in Docker, but similar technology. So we have Amazon biggest Amazon virtual machines, and we have 1,500 applications per one virtual machine. So that's the kind of density you can have compared to having virtual machines per each application. And now we are moving to OpenShift V3, and we will adapt the Docker format for as a way to package applications and platforms in OpenShift. And we will have something for orchestration. So usually Docker is good for that use case that you set up a new development environment and give it to your colleague or from development to testing production, move it between environments. And traditionally that has been done by having a manual step-by-step guide on what to do, like from to production people, there need to be exact guidelines how to do things. And usually that way there are still more changes, a bit of different versions of stuff and some configuration that wasn't mentioned in the documentation how to do that move. So Docker was easy. You could set up your own sandbox in Linux and install everything, make it work, and then you can have the exact copy to your colleague or from testing to production. And that's the use case at the moment that most are using Docker for, and how it came very popular, mostly with the developers. But if you go to more production-like applications and your applications consist of multiple platforms or like a multi-tier architectures, you have web services and backend services and so on, then you need to take care of high availability and scaling and these kind of things. Then you need some tool to orchestrate it. And we are using Kubernetes, which is Google's project. So Google has been using containers in production for all these their online applications, Gmail, YouTube, etc. Everything runs on containers. Even Google Cloud's virtual machines run inside container. So they are heavily using containers in Google. And we guided them to open source their orchestration tool last summer. So it's now open source project, and there's IBM, HP, etc. involved in that development. But we are the biggest one after Google developing that. So basically Kubernetes, you give a configuration on what you need from your application, what Docker images your applications consist of, how many of these instances of these needs to be running all the time, and you give that configuration to Kubernetes, and it will set up your application and take care that it stays up. So if some Docker dies, it sets up a new one and keeps score of that environment. So in the bigger applications, you need some tool to orchestrate that. So I will go through a bit of components in what is included in OpenShift V3. we have already launched the Red Hat Atomic Host. It's kind of hypervisor for containers, like you have in virtualization hypervisors. Red Hat Atomic Host is a minimal Red Hat Enterprise Linux that can run containers, and it's made very easy to update and maintain. There's an atomic update, so you don't update package by package, but you just say atomic update, and it will update whole operating system or nothing. So it's very minimal administration, and then you can run containers on top of that. And as I said, we will move to Docker-based format in containers. So from our point of view, Docker is a primarily de facto standard format to image format for containers. There are some others as well, like Rocket, and we are following those as well, but we hope that there will be one standard and not competing ones, and at the moment we bet on Docker. And one benefit I didn't mention from Docker is the immutable architecture. So I mean, we used to have those servers, or we still have those servers that you maintain by manually. It's usually end up that you are happy that it has been up and running for 10 years, but nobody knows what has been done to that server to keep it running, and then it's hard, nobody wants to touch them anymore. But with immutable architecture, usually you have automation to set up new environments, and if something breaks, you kill the environment and set up new one, and always fix the bugs in the automation, not maintaining the server. So it's good for being able to manage those in long run. Orchestration, I already mentioned, it will be based on Kubernetes. And picture how Kubernetes works in practice. There's a concept called pods. Pod can be one or more Docker instances. And those are the ones that you define in Kubernetes configuration, how they should operate, how they see each other. You can build like database as a service or something as a service that other applications use. You can define those and routing, how those applications are visible outside world, etc. I don't go into details here. OpenShift, in addition to having these Kubernetes and Docker, there's a interface layer for application development teams that they can create new environments, and you can standardize development platforms that are available for development teams and divide that there's somebody maintaining the platforms and somebody utilizing those, and it covers all that as well. You can try it out with openshift.com, how the developer experience looks like. All our applications will be available, all JPOS etc. will be available as a Docker image, but we support everything that is packaged as a Docker, available in Docker Hub. It doesn't have to be our stuff, and it's easy to package anything that runs on Linux into Docker format as well. So there will be all our integration platforms and business process management, etc. And we have certification program for our partners as well that can certify that it's a trusted source for having the Docker image. This I already mentioned. So for developers, there's web-based interface, IDE, and command line interfaces, etc. It's easy to automate things on top of OpenShift, like with continuous integration tools, etc., Git or so on. And then there's a build and deployment automation. So everything is based in as a Docker format. You can utilize directly when you define these Kubernetes configurations, you can define that it utilizes some out-of-the-box Docker image from Docker Hub or somewhere else. Or OpenShift can build your Docker images based on Docker has something called Docker file that defines how to build that image. OpenShift can run the build process for you if it's needed, or if the application is based on some Docker image and source code, it can utilize it so that, like for application server, there could be base Docker image for application server, and OpenShift can take care of the process of building the application and putting it inside or on top of that application server as an image. OpenShift will take care of networking configuration, so you can build overlay networks. If you have some part of the OpenShift running in your data center, part of, let's say in Amazon, it's possible to build a network so that the one application, all the containers see each other and think that they are in the same network. And the software-defined networking providers are applicable, but OpenVSwitch, which is the out of the box. And we will have our own registry available. You can utilize Docker Hub, but if you need company-wide registry, we have one inside OpenShift, and you can utilize our satellite as well. That is the Red Hat Linux management tooling. Storage. Kubernetes also takes care of mounting shared storage to containers, so you can define that there's in one application needs to be shared storage. That's possible to configure, and OpenShift will take care that it is attached to or mounted to these containers when they scale or so on. So this is the summary slide. We will move to our application development has changed. So the microservices kind of applications, they on DevOps, they need some kind of platform to take care. You can build it yourself or utilize something that is coming out of the box. And there's a market emerging for this platform as a service that used to be more like as a service, Heroku and these things. More for startups and only online application, only as a service. Now as architectures are changing, there's emerging new market for these kind of platform as a services. And we are one of the first ones to move in there. And we will base our things to open standards, de facto standards. Docker seems to be the winning one for container images. Kubernetes is very strong for orchestration. So if you are interested to test it out, it's not available yet, but it's everything we do is fully open source and developed in the community first. There's OpenShift Origin is the community name. There's the latest development, but enterprise version that is supported by us will be released at our summit that is held after midsummer, so pretty soon. And then there will be a lot of marketing material if you look for OpenShift, but OpenShift.com is the address at the moment. You can go and check the online service, and it's free for limited size of amount of containers. Okay, thank you. Questions? I have heard that before. I'm not sure if that's the latest one. So there has been some slowness to the Docker has this kind of layered file system. So if you take one Docker image, there are thousands of them available on Docker Hub online. You can take some component there and then you can change the configurations or add something on top of that. And there's a layered file system. So you add new layer and it doesn't break anything under that. And it adds some slowness, and you have experienced some slowness because of that. And you asked if Red Hat has been fixing that. I don't know the latest status, but I know that the Docker is under heavy development, and many think it's not yet production ready. Yeah, that would be one. Yeah, I'm not sure. But yeah, but one thing that performance is that you can run Docker or containers on bare metal directly as well. The usual use case is that you would like to have virtualization still underneath to have the easier management, but in some use cases we are targeting the networking, virtualization, things like that. When the real-time requirements are very, very strict, then it's more performant to have than operating or virtualization, that you don't have that extra layer. Thank you.
Please give a round of applause for